So this is a major effort. As you recall, when we approved plan area 2013, there were several questions who were barely recovering in terms of our economy, our job growth. There were several questions of our economy, our jobs, our businesses, and there was a strong request that we needed to address that more specifically, that while housing is a pressing issue, we also need to understand the dynamics of our economy. So Michael Weinberg at the Bay Area Council Economic Institute stepped in to work on this document, which compiles the perspective from the business community. And it's an effort to try to get their perspective into Plan Bay Area. Jeff Delisari is also here with us from the same team. Michael joined the Bay Area Council Economic Institute less than a year ago. And he's brought a lot of energy, a lot of strategic approaches to deal with this, with the questions that the business community is dealing with.
Great, thank you so much. The Bay Area Council Economic Institute is the independent research arm of the Bay Area Council, which is an organization of about 300 large employers in the nine county Bay Area. The Economic Institute is governed by a cross-sector board of trustees, though, which include Julie Pierce, Jerry Madsen, Ezra, and others. What we were doing here, though, as Miriam said, is really, you know, not just going back into our little rooms and thinking our best thoughts about this, but holding a bunch of meetings with leaders of the business community to provide their input into Plan Bay Area. So I personally agree with most of the recommendations, but that's not really my job here today. My job here is to deliver a report on a set of perspectives that the regional agencies thought were important for Plan Bay Area and be carried forward by those business leaders in different advocacy activities that they'll be engaging in coming out of this, not just related to Plan Bay Area specifically, but broader legislative advocacy and other issues. But we have a little bit of time, but I really want to make a few framing remarks. And that is that California has the highest rate of poverty in the nation. I mean, we've heard that before, but I'm not sure if it's really sunk in, at least for me. And the California Legislative Analyst Office is among those that have pointed out that the cost of housing is the primary driver of poverty in the state. And the higher cost of housing is caused by undersupply, period. Policies that constrain the production of housing may be temporarily in the interest of certain communities. These policies mostly benefit higher income communities, but they sometimes temporarily benefit lower income communities. However, on a systematic level, any policies that constrain the supply of housing work to keep the poverty rate in our state high, and therefore work against the interest of our state's low income residents. So this is what we're talking about. If we're talking about building more housing, better transportation to connect it, better education for folks that are going to have these jobs, it's a critical social equity issue, but also a critical business issue. And I liked the part of the conversation earlier that it actually our inability for various different reasons to build housing has actually gotten to the point where folks think it is a drag on the nation's economic growth. That's a pretty big deal. And the other thing to say here, though, is that the housing affordability and housing supply are at a crisis level, but this isn't because of a recent rapid rate of economic and job growth in the Bay Area. It's a crisis point that we're at because of a generation of underbuilding. Since the 1970s, we're more than a million units short in the greater Bay Area alone. This report does not propose to blame any particular actor for the situation. We all share in the blame to some extent. In fact, I almost don't want to say a lot of the times that the Bay Area Council has been working on housing policy for 70 years, because it sort of leads to the question, so why haven't you guys fixed it by now? It's something we're all going to have to work on collectively, and I think there's a greater understanding that we have to get more serious about producing housing in the Bay Area, and there are a lot of things that stand in that way. So as I mentioned, this is intended to provide an input into Plan Bay Area. It was funded by MTC and supported by ABAG. Hello, Therese, thank you so much for being here. And I'm going to move through the recommendations really quickly because I'd love to have at least some time for conversation. So on the housing supply side, one of the questions is what happens when communities do not build the amount of housing that the region needs them to build, that their neighbors need them to build, that the children of the people who live in their communities need them to build, that lower income residents need them to build. Well, if we propose a number of potential ways of holding these local communities accountable. This includes by right zoning districts, regional hearing body to hear appeals on housing. But there are also other more incremental solutions that are available here. And one of them is doing a lot more on accessory dwelling units. And that's actually going to be a big initiative of ours here over the course of the next year. And some regional cities have actually done some great stuff on accessory dwelling units. Increasing the density of housing within priority development areas is something we're very supportive of. And so we want to see this housing supply expand, but there are lots of different tools to expand that supply of housing, and ADUs are one of them. And then, of course, there's changing the broader tax policy that puts us all in this bad situation where we're financially disincented to produce housing. That's probably a longer term public education process on changing Prop 13, essentially, and the way we distribute property tax across cities. That said, that's the original sin, right? I mean, that's the thing that has got us in this situation more than anything else, and is the thing that we need to think about if we actually want to really deal with it in a serious way. Gets into the issue of things that restrict the supply of housing. Obviously, impact fees through taxing housing will cause you to have less housing. There's CEQA, and there's also opportunities to streamline the approvals and essentially bring down the cost of housing, leverage new building technologies, and so on. We also look at a number of other areas in the report because really you can't think about housing without thinking about transportation and vice versa. And unfortunately, our friends in the federal government are not helping us out very much in the transportation arena. Federal transportation funding and infrastructure funding generally has really fallen off a cliff. And the solutions that we're left with, sort of local health solutions, are really not good ones. The local self-help measures are what they are, and we think we need to look at a number of different things, including creating an empowered regional agency to fund infrastructure projects, give it more ability to raise funding. And it isn't just about the amount of funding you come up with. There are lots of solutions in this report to drive the efficiency of project delivery, as well as coming up with funds to support it. And there are traditional and alternative finance sources. The council for years, and my colleague Sean Randolph has been working on public-private partnerships, but whether it's traditional finance or alternative finance, we need some finance. And we believe that this finance needs to come primarily, needs to be coming from the regional level and going towards regional priority projects. There's plenty of opportunities, though, to use the existing system better. This would involve aligning the region's 26 agencies. So in my position, I often get calls from people from around the world, and they say, man, the Bay Area is doing so well. You know about Bay Area government, right? Tell me exactly how Bay Area does government, and we'll set up our government to be just like the Bay Area's government so that we'll get, the great economic outcomes that you guys are getting. And I'm like, well, take your single regional transportation agency and break it up into 26. No, I mean, the truth is that we can do more to drive efficiency within our system. We need to do more, and we already are doing more. We need to build on investing in transportation corridors rather than sort of locally, transportation areas defined by, particular geographic boundaries. The transportation corridors that are just getting, you might as well just walk over the Altamont Pass at this point. Also 101 south of San Jose, and 80 is always good times. So looking at those corridors and planning for those corridors that stretch across many different jurisdictions is something that there's some good energy behind already. We also think that we need to incentivize the use of the latest technology. I mean, it's really, amazing to me. We're the center of the innovation economy. Everybody wants to hear about how amazing we are. But we really don't leverage our sort of smart grid type technologies to make our transportation systems as efficient as they can be. We can do a lot more with the roads and transportation systems that we currently have. And like with the housing projections, we're not doing that through lack of technology. We're not doing that because it's impossible to do. We're doing that because of the political environment and a series of political and policy decisions that have been made that make even just metering the entrance to freeways a gigantic issue when there's no real technological issue that stands in the way of our doing that. You heard about this some in Cynthia's absolutely fantastic presentation that really teed this up really, really well. But there's a huge skill gap in California, and that's due to the fact that, as she showed, most of the job growth going forward is going to be in these higher skilled areas of healthcare and IT. And so we need to really be investing in a much more serious way in our human capital here in the Bay Area. And shocker, the Bay Area Council thinks it should be done on a regional level. But it's not just us. The economies are not organized on the local level. Economies, the workforce, economic opportunity is organized on a regional level. And so there's been a lot of great momentum recently around getting the community colleges together and coordinating more regionally. The workforce funding is now flowing somewhat more regionally. And we think there needs to be more of that, and we're actually stepping up and playing a significant role in getting better information from the regional employer community to the regional training community. And so here's the last slide. Essentially, we're a region, we need to start acting like one. So one of the things that we noticed is that, I actually got a call the other day, and we ended up doing a project for a new business that was wanting to site in a part of the region, and they wanted to know, where's your regional economic development commission? And we said, well, there really isn't one. We'll help you out if we can. We did have a little bit of flex and we made it happen, but it's not something that the Economic Institute is particularly well set up to do. It's not something that a lot of smaller cities are particularly well set up to do. So what we want to do here is to have a better regional economic development planning and assistance capacity to support the cities, to support the business community. We believe that it should probably be some sort of partnership between the business community and the regional governments. And I will just end with the fact that we would love to see the process of ABAG and MTC merging going forward. We think that will be quite helpful, and what we want to inject into that conversation is the idea that this merged regional agency could have additional economic development capabilities to help with economic development in the region. So that's a lot of information in a very short period of time, but we only have 5 minutes for questions, so I'm going to wrap it up now. I don't know if we can go over, but I'm going to wrap it up now and we can start the conversation.
Thank you very much. Let's have the questions. Again, from my right to left, please take your name tag and put it up so that I can. Pat, you can start the questions.
First of all, I thought we go to 3:00.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was 12:30 to 2:30.
Oh, to 2:30. Okay, so we have more than 5 minutes for questions.
All right, then. I can just go back over this more slowly. Yeah. All right. Let's get talking.
Actually, I really appreciate you giving a presentation on this, and I've read it a couple of times, and I guess each time I read it, my blood boils a little bit more. Having worked for the federal government for over 40 years, I realized that creating incentives for states and local governments to achieve goals that are national or statewide are really important. But taking away the legislative authority of governments, whether it's state or locals, goes counter to what our communities want. Communities want more locally based decisions, not something being put down on them. That's sort of the for me is the fundamental nature of the U.S. government. You talk here about capping fees, and so I was really actually kind of surprised that the area council or the area institute didn't have a provision in here that something that we in the League of California Cities had talked about when we did Prop 1A back in 2004, 2005, where the poison pill part of Prop 13, where as the change of ownership of houses, the property tax goes up commensurate with the actual sale. That's not true for commercial developments. And it's only when you have a true sale, true exchange, does that property value go up, and thus the property tax. I think one of the reasons why local governments have the need to raise fees in order to process applications throughout is because we don't get the property tax that is really needed. So I was kind of curious, why didn't the Bay Area Council actually take that issue head on? And instead of proposing necessarily a cap on fees, why not the business community in the nine-county Bay Area stepping up to the plate and allowing when a property changes, whether it's within a corporation, or LLC, or whatever, really pay for the value,
sure,
the property tax for the value of that property? That's my first question, and then I'll
yeah.
the second one.
Yeah, I mean, let me just answer your last question. I mean, the other stuff, I mean, you know, it's the input of the business community, if your own perspective on it, that's fine. But the problem with split role, well, there are a bunch of them. One, it actually doesn't raise as much money as people think that it's going to raise, and there are projections that I can, you know, I point you to. So it's not quite the fantasy that a lot of folks think that it is. But if the problem is the relative advantage of permitting and building commercial property versus residential property, right? So right now, it's in the interest of all cities to build all the commercial property and have their neighbor build all the housing, right? If we change split role, we actually make it even more financially advantageous for people to have commercial property versus residential property. So that actually takes the dynamic that we are concerned about and accentuates it, rather than actually fixing the underlying set of incentives that all work against the production of housing. Basically, I mean, this is the opposite of what a tax system is supposed to do. In a tax system, you're supposed to tax the things you don't want to happen, largely. And here, our taxes, our regulations, our fees, you name it, all work against the economic well-being of the people in California. They work against the, you know, potential economic growth that we have in the region, because they work against producing a supply of housing.
I guess I would differ with you, because when I became an elected official for the first time 20 years ago in the city of Novato, my city manager spent a lot of time telling me that it costs more for the city to provide for the services for a household than for necessarily commercial development. So, you know, he always said that that we need to have more commercial development, but yet to pay their own share to help pay for the offset for the cost of having that housing. Nevertheless, Novato, we've done a really good job in achieving Arvina, the cycle before last, and hopefully we'll do more this next year.
Well, thank you.
Cycle.
I want to help you out. I want to help out San Jose. I want to help out the cities that are seriously committed to building housing in spite of the fact that there's a collective action problem.
But then, right? and I'd love to have this debate because, frankly, there is a development that's happening right now in the city where the developer would rather take an in-lieu fee, whereas we have an inclusionary zoning requirement for 20%. So we get that lower level of income. And so there's really not any economic advantage for companies or for the housing industry to do that lower threshold. They'd rather pay because it's cheaper than actually constructing it. So there's other concerns I have in some of your recommendations, like taking away the loss of local approval authority if we don't achieve the RENA. Cities typically don't build the housing. And like with this last RENA cycle, all the cities not only had to approve the housing element, they actually had to rezone to be able to allow the building industry to not have to go through that cost of rezoning the property. But yet, not all developers are coming in and building it. So we are going to be, according to your recommendation, cities and counties are going to be penalized for the fact that the building industry may not want to build that particular housing in that location where it was rezoned. So.
Yeah, I mean, point well taken. You would want to set it up in such a way that it did not have that unintended consequence. But the idea that all of the cities, I mean, come on, we know what we're talking about, right? I mean, not all of the cities in the Bay Area are significantly committed to developing housing, and it's just the, you know, building industry association that won't build houses there, right? I mean, cities that like demonstrate a significant commitment towards trying to get the housing built in their communities are not the types of cities that would need to be held accountable. But there are, and we all know this, cities that have no intention whatsoever of building any more housing. And that creates a collective action problem in which they put their, you know, neighbors at a disadvantage. So no, it would not be those folks that had a significant commitment to trying to get as much housing built as they wanted.
I'd love to have a panel discussion where there's community members that also want to talk about maintaining the quality of life. I guess I have a question for Miriam about this report. I'm not sure if she's still here again. Miriam, I am concerned about a lot of the recommendations and policy statements in here that really impinge on local control. And it's my understanding in reading this that this document will, quote, inform us as we go forward with Plan Bay Area 2017, but we're not necessarily going to be adopting by right these recommendations in this report, correct?
No. This, I mean, as Mike explained, this is input from the business community. We wanted input from the business community. This is what we have. While there are some elements where we might agree, where you might agree, there are many other elements that where we will probably have a lot of disagreements. So this is an independent document, and it was not meant to be something that we all like. It was meant to be something that conveys the perspective of the business community.
Yeah, and the other, you know, the other point there is that there was a sense that had there been more effort on the front end to incorporate the perspective of the business community, that we, I mean, you know, you can sort of do things on the front end or do things on the back end, and there are obviously no guarantees associated with if you take more input on the front end, you won't have trouble on the back end, but the business voice, we're attempting to make sure that it is constructively engaged in this conversation at an earlier point, so that we can have a, you know, a series of consensus recommendations to take into the in consideration a number of different stakeholders and get more buy-in to the Plan Bay Area process. So this is all designed to support the Plan Bay Area process, but as I mentioned, I don't necessarily personally agree with all this. I hope you understand, like, my job here is to sort of be a spokesperson for this particular process. So in response to your questions, I gave those answers, but that's the point of this process.
And I guess I would contend that there's a missing voice too at the table, and that's the voice of the people. My last question is to Miriam, is that is when we approve the people's places and prosperity, on page 22 of that report, it talks about this report and the fact that it will help inform the development. It's been brought to my attention that some members of the community feel as though that by ABAG taking that position and approving people's places and things, that we're actually approving this document. I want to make sure that you state on the record very clearly so that I can talk to my community that we're not approving the recommendations that are in this when we adopted the people, places, and prosperity.
Thank you, Mike. A couple comments and a question. Maybe just picking up on this last issue. As I read it, I think the main recommendation that's being made is to tie regional funding to local action, in a sense, to try to use the funding as either an incentive, a characteristic, if you may, not to, and that we shouldn't be rewarding communities that are not approving housing in line with regional goals. I think that, I mean, certainly it goes a little bit further there, and I think, Pat, some of your questions are to that, the potential loss of local control. But I think, I'll just say, from our perspective, you're raising an important issue about how do we get to regional outcomes that are most important. Okay, second comment, I wanted to just pick up on the split role, fiscal impact of housing, and then ask about the projections, and we'll Cynthia into this. Just on the split role issue and the fiscal impact of housing, two things. One, there is some new information that's coming out actually from analysis in San Jose that in fact new residential development may in fact be fiscally positive. So that number might be in flux, and it depends probably primarily on the price point. Density matters certainly in some regard, but price point seems to be a more important driver. And so I think that's a critical issue insofar as cities may not or shouldn't be making the fiscal argument against housing as much as they have been historically, because sometimes they conflate new housing with existing housing when looking at property tax revenues.
Right.
I mean, they look at all housing together and how much revenue they get from it, as opposed to just looking at new housing independent of existing housing stock.
Yeah, I think Nancy's presented on, Nancy Klein at San Jose's presented on that. Yeah, not all new housing is net negative. The higher density housing, the higher price point housing is not net negative. The problem is the value of that housing erodes over time. So, you know, you build a whole bunch of housing and maybe you're doing pretty well for a little while, and then, you know, the property tax revenues go down and down and down. So over time, even the very high density housing ends up being net negative. But you're right that there are different considerations around density and price.
Yeah, I think there's some also similar concerns on commercial property. It's all about assumptions of turnover. Just that's probably too much for this conversation. The other thing on split role, though, one, you were saying split role would change incentive even more away from housing, but you could design the split role in such a way that, in fact, it actually were some kind of a tax sharing scheme. The money would go to a certain place and then could get redistributed based on some set of requirements. So I don't think it's inherent. It would be in how that kind of policy gets designed.
Yeah, I haven't seen, because there are split role proposals, and generally they keep the existing, you know, way of distributing money. But yeah, I mean, your split role proposal, I kind of like.
Well, let's play. Okay, so last question. So when I look at your numbers and the numbers we just heard from Cynthia and from ABAG, it looks like your numbers are assuming 1.2 million job growth between 2015 and 2040, as opposed to 600,000 for ABAC. So that's double.
Job growth or
job
housing
growth?
Growth?
Job growth on page 31 in your document. 3.7 million in 2015, up to 4.9 million. Is that 1.2 million? So it looks like that's a double the number of job growth that the ABAC number is. And again, if I'm reading it correctly, about 180,000 more housing units projected. So
right.
If you could just say a little bit about putting you on the spot to a certain extent, but what are your thoughts on the ABAC projection? Are they too low? And in particular, as I'm reflecting more on, and maybe Cynthia to bring you in, as I'm reflecting a little bit more on the presentation you just gave before, are we under-assuming the Bay Area's ongoing economic performance? Meaning, are we under-assuming our continued ability to maintain a really dynamic, viable set of industries that are globally competitive that continue to grow at a pretty fast rate? From the ABAC side, is that what you're including here is an assumption that this region stays economically dynamic?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that really struck me is we had Daniel Lowenstein, the number two of UCSF, come and present on our housing panel at the event that we did for this the other day. And UCSF is the most amazing medical research facility in the world. It's driving a tremendous amount of the regional economic activity. You would think that its major threats would be competitors or cost of healthcare or what have you. He said the number one threat to UCSF is housing. right? And this is true for their students. And the thing is, housing affordability is not just a question of affordable housing. It's true for their students, it's true for their residents, it's true for their highly paid doctors. They cannot attract and retain the talent because of the cost of housing. And so one of the things that's really, really been very interesting about this conversation, which I've appreciated, is the recognition that these things are endogenous, right? So if you don't build the housing, you won't get the economic growth. And so if you leave the series of policies in place, you end up with it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? You end up with the lower level of economic growth and the lower level of job growth because you haven't changed the policies that would allow you to build the housing to power and accommodate that growth. So I wouldn't say that there's any sort of technical difference or disagreement between the sort of ABAG numbers and the numbers that the business community is putting forward, but it's based on a different set, it's based on almost a different policy environment where we're saying, look, if you adopt policies which are positive for economic growth, then you will see and have to have this. Now, if we don't want that level of economic growth for whatever reason, then we can keep the policies that we have. But these things are endogenous to each other.